Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Good evening there in our nation's capital, Washington, D.C. It's only 5 o'clock here in California in our West Coast headquarters of the Congressional Prayer Conference, but I know it's 8 o'clock there in the East Coast, and so good evening and good afternoon, whichever is appropriate. Just before I went on the air, I received a phone call from our nation's capital from someone in the capital who wanted to let me know that I had just surged ahead of Trump and Cruz in the presidential poll. I'm just telling you what they told me. I don't know if they were trying to boost my ego. If they were, it did. But at any rate, we're settled down here and get down to the real nitty-gritty of the show. This show is sponsored by the Congressional Prayer Conference of Washington, D.C. Not the Prayer Caucus, it's the Prayer Conference. We work with the Prayer Caucus. In fact, we're going to be talking to you tonight about some of the prayer requests that the Prayer Caucus has put out that we want to talk about. And that is, and I'll tell you how to get in touch with that, you can go to the CPCFoundation.com. CPCFoundation.com. And that stands for Congressional Prayer Caucus Foundation.com. If you want to go to our website, we're not as short. Our website's been there a long time. Our website was there in the year 2000. And that website, the way you get in touch with us is go to Congressional Prayer Conference of Washington, D.C.org. Congressional Prayer Conference of Washington, D.C.org. We have a spiritual connection with them, but no government connection. Personal connections, spiritual connections, yes. And I received this morning an email from the caucus, and that email came to me, and it was sent to me by a dear, dear, sweet sister in the Lord. Now, she didn't send it only to me. She sent it to a lot of people. But she sends it to prayer warriors. And I am appreciative of the fact that she sent this to me, and I sent her back an email immediately and said, with your blessings, I'm going to be passing along some of your prayer targets. They put out a weekly prayer update with national prayer points and praise reports. And we give those to you from them, as well as some of our other friends in D.C., Pierre Bynum, Sarah Ballinger, Minister Johnny Rice, Minister there on the Hill as well, Brother Jeff Wright. And we receive these, and we'll share those prayer requests with you. Now, do we have a caller on the line?
Yes, we do, Pastor Greg. This is Bill and Eugene.
Well, God bless you, fellas. Ladies and gentlemen, you have heard me talk about these men, and most of what I have said has been very good. I'm only kidding. It's all been good. But these gentlemen are behind a work called the Death of the Justice System. Bill and Eugene have been promoting a book. We took some of those books to our nation's capital. We left them there with the intention of having my vice presidential candidate, Blossom Brackman, deliver them to the Supreme Court. Those have not been delivered yet. But when you try to deliver something to the Supreme Court, it takes quite a while. So we're going to be getting those books to them because of all the people that need to see this book, the justices, the judges of the Supreme Court need it most. Bill, tell us, our listening audience, a little bit about the death of the justice system, would you please?
Appreciative of that. This book, Death of the Justice System, is a book regarding Eugene Zurek, history of the courts in the Seventh Circuit Court in Illinois. truck driver working for the city of Chicago. He gave Mayor Daley a $1,000 contribution. Then he proceeded to get terminated and fired because he gave the opponent political leader some money. And this was the case. That's what precipitated the case, is that King gave a donation to Mayor Daley when, and then Mayor Daley didn't get the, didn't become a mayor, and the next mayor retaliated against King by firing. And this is a case about Eugene Zurich versus the city of Chicago. For anybody that's interested, they can go up on Google Scholar and just type in Zurich, it's W-Z-O-R-E-K, versus the city of Chicago. There's four federal cases up there, three of them in the Seventh Circuit, and then one in the Seventh Circuit Court of Appeals.
Now, before you go any further, that, give us Eugene's name again. Spell it for us, please.
Yes, it's Zurich. Eugene, Zurich. That's W-Z-O-R-E-K. That's Whiskey, Zulu, Echo, Romeo, Oscar, Kilo. So it's Zurich. W-Z-O-R-E-K. And it's versus the city of Chicago. So if you go up to, you look to go to the law library or go to Google and Google Scholar, look up cases, and you look up federal cases, and you type in Zurich, that's W-Z-O-R-E-K, versus City of Chicago, there'll be four cases, all in the Seventh Circuit, that come up. And those cases were the cases that Gene went to federal court to get his job back.
Well, we're encouraging our folks to get a copy of that book. The book that is out is called The Death of the Justice System, and his cases, those four cases, are examples of how he did not get justice. He got ran over by the court. And tell us a little bit about that.
Well, the CrownOakPress.com. It's like a crown sitting on an oak tree, and the oak root is on a wine press. So it's CrownOakPress.com. And then that's the book, and that's available for $26.99. It's available on Amazon for $9.99.
Okay, and the title of the book is called Death of the Justice System.
Yes, it's called Death by Linda Akers, and it's second edition, volume one. It has a picture of a tape machine on it, tape recorder machine, one of the old TIAC tapes, reel-to-reel tapes.
Yeah.
So there are the earlier books that have a red cover, and that was in 2004. Made by 740 pages by another printing house, also by Linda Akers, but that was the first edition. The second edition, volume one, is done by Crown Oak Press in Florida, and then also the ebook is available on Amazon. Both of those books have a real tape recording in it, so that's how you tell the difference between the the first edition and the second edition.
Okay.
You want to get the second edition because it's only 386 pages. And what we did, the second edition is just Eugene's story and his evidence. And the book basically is self-documenting. Now, if you remember Kent Hovind, when he and I were on your program, we got connected with Rudy and his wife, Davis, and we started to talk about, Rudy started talking about Kent Hovind about his tapes, and all of a sudden he got out. And I understand that there's another pastor in Florida still in jail. You know what the condition or the status of that incarceration is?
All I know is he is still in jail. But I do understand that there's some effort being made, but we're not really sure what's happening at this point. And if anybody out there knows, please call us. We'll be more than happy to let you share with us. I've forgotten his name right now,
Was it Paul or something like that?
No, that doesn't ring a bell. I'm sorry, I don't remember that name, but...
I don't either. Now, as we started to talk to Rudy Davis, we said, well, go ask for the audio tapes. Now, Pastor Holbein had three grand juries. Each one of those grand juries had a transcript and a tape. So when Rudy started inquiring about the tapes for those grand juries, and knowing that what Gina is basically known, that the tapes and the transcripts do not agree. So you have a written transcript, you have an oral tape, and when you play them side by side, they don't agree. And that's basically fraud. And the transcript does not match the audio tape. Now, of course, there's Seventh Circuit Judge Posner in the Smith versus U.S. District Court case that says that the only official record is the audio tape. That's why, you know, when you get the audio tape and that record, and that has to agree with the written transcript. And what's happening is they don't agree. And since they don't agree, there was fraud involved. In any case, going back to Throckmorton back in the 1800s, fraud initiates everything, just voids everything. So when you do something in a court of law or in a court that is based upon fraud, that allows you to go over to the wall and push that big reset button, say the case is, you know, basically what you're doing is when you ask for the audio tapes, you're going to the ref, say, I want the phone.
All right, Bill, I have a guest in the studio with me, and I want to go to him now. He used to be the host and the co-host of this program when I was out of town, and his name is Mark Rafter. And Brother David, if you'll get that camera adjusted there a little bit. Yeah, thank you. Welcome, brother.
Thank you, brother. It's good to be back on U.S. soil.
Amen.
I just arrived last night from China. And I'm here to testify that China's open for business and that God's work is being done. A college service there and a couple of private schools, and the brothers and sisters in the Lord are just growing and glowing.
Amen. And folks, for those of you who may not remember, Brother Mark was my campaign manager when I was running for president the last time I ran. But he bailed out on me this time, went to China.
Well, but, I'm at a different position now. I'm appointed as an ambassador.
Amen.
And registered with the United Nations. And World Peace One has appointed me ambassador to China.
Amen. Praise
and
the Lord.
So,
I can say I remember you when.
Yeah, I'm kind of... You know, it's a wonderful thing how God takes our lives, even at the lowest point.
Yes, yes.
And He's a God of restoration and forgiveness and renewal.
Amen.
And when He decides to use us, and we've been on the sideline or we've been sitting on the bench and say, Lord, will you put me in the game?
Amen.
And it's not about our plan. It's about His plan.
It's about His plan.
And He says, you're going to China. China? He says, you have a question? No, Lord, wherever you want. And He sends us, and He begins moving the chess pieces on the board as only God can do, and He gives us great divine favor that we are positioned. And I had a wonderful time with the vice chairman of China, and they threw a special private state lunch for us, and... the door is open. I prayed at a school, did almost 2,000 children, and I always say a prayer before I go on the field to do any soccer or anything that Heavenly Father, please protect the children that no one would get injured.
Amen.
And be in their hearts so that they can have open hearts to learn and be of a learning mind.
Amen.
I speak Colossians 3:2, set our hearts and minds on the things above. Amen.
Amen.
And if I might say,
sure, right.
The director of the Bureau of Physics, which is like our president's physical fitness program, mm-hmm. was behind me. I did not know this.
Mm.
I just prayed. I don't have any fear. It's against the law for a foreigner to preach or pray in public.
Ah,
they
yeah.
don't want any proselytizing. He walked over to the director of the school and said, if Dr. Mark wants to pray for protection of our children, you let him pray.
Amen. Amen. Well, that's the favor of God, obviously. And ladies and gentlemen, Brother Mark Rafter has seen the favor of God, not only on him, but on the nation, on this ministry when he was with us here in the TV studio. But Mark, tell him a little bit about the sort of working, sort of the nuts and bolts of what you do in China. Many of them may or may not know. I know some of them know you and know about you and what you do. Ladies and gentlemen, he's not only known as Mark, but he's known as Marco Polo. Tell us a little bit about that.
I have really three prongs that I do in everywhere I go now, 32 countries. And the last two big ministries have been and in China. But my heart's really drawn to China. God's changed my heart. I used to hate China and the communists and all of that. But God has put a love in my heart because you win with the love of Jesus.
Amen.
And that has given me great favor because that true love is there for the China and Chinese people. I call the Panda people.
Yeah, amen.
And one of their top leaders called me Marco Polo. And ever since, everyone in China calls me Marco Polo. I'm the modern day Marco Polo going back to China. Like Marco Polo did, he never got to go back. He lived there 22 years. And come back and tell the West China's modern story. The unique thing about Marco Polo is really kind of an interesting thing. When he came back, his book was written, and it outsold the Bible.
My goodness.
The greatest selling book in history.
Yeah.
You know, Donald Trump says number one book above his book. Well, it was way above his book.
Well, by the way, in reference,
and it's the number one seller.
Amen.
And that's a big thing.
Amen. And in reference to Mr. Trump, I got a call just before I came on the air from a pollster in Washington, D.C., and he said, as of 4 o'clock California time, Wiley Drake was ahead in the polls, ahead of Trump and Cruz.
I love it. So what I do is three things. Ministry, I always serve the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And by him serve Father God.
Amen.
And hopefully walking through the power of the Holy Spirit. Second thing I do is I've run a nonprofit called Fit to Play that is an educational sports charity that we have done. We'll start celebrating our 18th year, March 17th. We've done 400,000 children in the United States and 5,000 in China. Opening the door so that Dr. Mark Rafter, Coach Mark, can go into every public school all across China.
And when you go, you're not there to proselytize.
I am not.
You're not there to Americanize.
I'm not.
You're there to use sports, and the name of your organization is Fit to Play. And so tell us how you dovetail.
Not only fit to play on the field, but in the game of life.
Amen.
So teaching whole life, which includes our spiritual nature.
Amen.
Now for us and our listeners, that spiritual nature is through the blood atonement of the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Because no one comes to the Father but through him.
Amen.
But we are providing two things when we go there in the spiritual sense, is we are a light and a testimony of Christ, and being doers of the faith in serving, loving our neighbor as ourselves. So keeping the second commandment of Christ. And number two, obviously, it's very clear that we are winning hearts and minds by wise as a serpent, soft as a dove.
Yeah. Now, as you do that, fit to play. Now, obviously, that involves sports. Is that ping pong? Is that football? Is it, what is it?
Well, it's amazing you said that, because now I'm an associate producer for the ping pong movie.
Oh, really?
That started about putting China and America together, that opened and brought China into the international community by the work of Dr. Henry Kissinger and the great Zhou Enlai, or Zhou Enlai, one of the greatest men of peace on the planet, that began the opening. And that ping pong movie is about the U.S. team captain of ping pong and the China team captain who became lifetime friends. Mm-hmm. And it's therefore he opened the door for Mr. Nixon to go to China. And for that, and I stood on the actual spot where that document was signed, and China became a part of the international community. And that was the beginning of a long journey. There's been some bumps in the road.
Well, of course.
And sometimes it's even been a little tension. But the journey is long, and as goes the U.S.-China relationship, so goes peace of the world.
Amen.
And they will be the potential partner for us in this this antithesis of Russia, Iran, and the Middle East. Mm-hmm. Those who would maybe not keep our back. Mm-hmm. And while right now we're beginning that planting of that seed of friendship, and there's some interdependency that occurs because we're synergistically working in commerce and trade. Mm. And so they're becoming dependent on the United States, and the United States is becoming a little dependent on them. And when you have that kind of dependency that equates to our economies, which is the welfare of our people, war isn't very intelligent.
That's right.
And then the last thing I do is in Marco Polo, is Marco Polo was originally appointed by the Pope as an emissary to the court under the Emperor Kublai in the 13th century. And when he got there, he got great favor with Kublai, and the emperor liked him and appointed him his ambassador all across China. And so he gave him a treasure map.
Mm.
And my grandfather gave me the treasure map, and I have the treasure map, and now I go back to China on an adventure as a treasure seeker that Marco Polo hid all over China. And I found out when I go there that I didn't find gold and I didn't find silver, but I found the greatest treasure of all is friendship.
Amen.
And
Amen.
So that is really a Christ-centered, because Amen. When Jesus is your friend, you've got a best friend Amen. Who will never leave you nor forsake you under any circumstance, no matter what the hour is. And I'm here to testify, friends, that when that's in your heart,
Amen.
That's truly the peace that passes all understanding.
Amen. And you know, interestingly enough, as you talk about this, I'm reminded, very Americanized and very Christianized, but I'm reminded of the teaching that all the world teaches, and that is what Jesus said when he said, a man who has a friend, and Jesus said, he is a friend that sticketh closer even than a brother. And so that brotherhood, that friendship, whatever you want to call it, is indeed transferred through and from the Christian motif, but into this friendship motif. And you know, I thought it was very interesting the first time I talked with you several years ago in reference to this emphasis it would be on sports. Now, you know and I know I'm not a big sports fan. I'm not against it or anything, but I just never have. When I was a kid, I grew up being a rodeo cowboy.
Yeah, but soccer's a real kick in the grass.
Yeah. But anyway, I've not been a big sports fan, but I thought it was interesting in reference to what happened in China and what happened with sports, that it wasn't a football, soccer, you know, the macho thing. It was ping pong.
Well, there, believe it or not, the elite of China, and China has more billionaires now than America, and many, many multimillionaires being made, especially farmers, because a lot of folk to feed over there.
Yeah.
And I'm telling you, China is open for business.
Amen. Amen.
Anyone who wants to do business in China, in the world's biggest market, all they have to do is contact me. The American Chinese CEO Society is being that bridge of connectivity. And for Chinese, the USA-China Investment Group is now doing cross-border, and we're bringing students here.
Amen.
And placing those students into corporations here, not just sending them back. There's 250,000 Chinese students, 70,000 graduate, and they go back, but they don't have any business experience. And those who have come to Christ here during their time of school are going back, and they're frustrated because they can't get a job because they don't have experience. So we've created to have that experience here, so when they go back, they're applying godly principles to running their family business. And that is a great way to change China. Jesus says he does not want revolution in China.
Right.
We want an evolution of change by winning the hearts and souls and minds of men and women. And so this avenue is an avenue to do that. And at the same time, I'm here to testify, and brother, you know my heart. My heart is to see the labor and toil of completing and perfecting the saints, wherever they are,
Amen.
God's people, and encouraging them, correction, exhortation, encouragement, and exhortational encouragement. And I'm telling you, brothers and sisters out there, we need your help.
Amen.
Our brothers and sisters in China, there's in the rural areas, and they're saying, brother, we have no shepherd. We need a shepherd. We want to grow. They're thirsting for the things of God.
Amen.
And I want to tell you, our media and some entities who use the word communism, who call themselves ministries, who are really looking for donations, that are wanting to overthrow the China government because of pains of the past. I'm not saying they're not justified. I see China as a rose, and obviously a rose has thorns. I'm not a fool to understand that there's no thorns. But like a small boy, I choose to smell the aroma of the flower and build upon that rather than to pierce my fingers with thorns. Jesus already took those piercings for me. But in this case, these brothers and sisters, about 60% of the population of China is Taoist. They believe in one God. And it's not necessarily the same way that we believe, but it's very much like a Jehovah God and a little more of mysticism and Buddhism thrown in. 10% of the population is Christian and growing. That's 140 million Christians.
I was going to say 10% may sound like a little until you put it to...
They have a heart of a... That is like the Jesus Freak movement of the old 10th days of Chuck Smith. They want to preach the gospel and get everybody saved and get the whole country changed. 5% is Buddhist and loving Buddhist. They love us Christians because we're spiritual. And about 5% is Muslim. And that's not so good in China because it's in the western provinces and they border the five Khans. And right now that's a problem. And then, of course, 3% is communist.
Amen.
And then there's 50 ethnic religions that are tribals. So that's really the background. And the greatest Christian number is in the Christian faith is the growth in China.
Amen.
Even some leaders will whisper, hey, I'm a Christian too.
Yeah, amen.
And
amen.
So that's changing. And we, God's people here, have a fruitful avenue to sow in to our brothers and sisters. Even if you write, just simply write a sermon and it gets translated that they can teach because they don't all have, and many of them have Bibles.
Yeah, amen.
So I want to encourage every one of Pastor Drake's listeners.
Amen.
There's a field of plenty.
Amen.
And they need us, and it's our heart to serve them, our brothers and sisters, and they ask for our prayers every day.
Amen. Thank you, Brother Mark, and we have a gentleman on the line with us from back in Washington, D.C. I believe Minister Johnny Rice is on with us. Are you there, my brother?
Praise the Lord, Pastor. Great to be with the men of God tonight.
Well, brother, tell me the report that you gave me earlier before we went on the air. What was that report that you heard?
Well, folks, let me give you the report. I was listening but a man of God named Wiley Drake was first place in the polls out with 77% of the percentage, and I mean totally over Donald Trump, who's my personal. Well, I got to be personal. You know, I love Pastor Wiley, so he's my number one. But my second favorite is Donald Trump.
Okay.
And then after that, Ted Cruz. So this is the news that we're getting to you straight from C-SPAN Radio and Iowa Caucuses.
Well, brother, thank you for that, and we praise the Lord for Minister Johnny Rice, who's there on Capitol Hill, who goes around on Capitol Hill, prays in many of the places that Brother Mark and I have prayed, on the steps of the Supreme Court, and really all over the Hill.
The U.S. Supreme Court.
The U.S. Supreme Court.
Because there's a Supreme Court that's higher.
That's right. Yeah, the U.S. Supreme Court. Thank you for that correction. And we thank the Lord for the opportunity. And Minister Johnny Rice, thank you so much for joining us today. And
let me offer a prayer
for
Pastor Rice. Father, in the name of Jesus, lift up and pray with and for Pastor Rice and all that you are doing in, through, and upon him. And we would ask for your hedge of protection. We speak Psalm 91 over him.
Amen.
And over his flock, over his family and his friends. And we would ask and encourage that you strengthen the commitment that he's made, and that we would see the spokes continue to flow out, and that the wheel, when it spins, would look like one, in Jesus' name.
Amen. And one of the things that we did this morning, as all of you know, the name of this organization is Congressional Prayer Conference of Washington, D.C. There is another one called the Congressional Prayer Caucus, and that is an official caucus. We have the name, but we're not official.
Well, we'll bring Congress. Them a handkerchief, and when they caucus,
okay,
they'll be able to take care of that.
All right, very good.
But we're going to conference.
But we work with them. They're very, and we love them dearly, because we're doing the same thing in a different way. Sister that is one of the facilitators, as I am, and so forth, for the caucus. I'm here at the conference to discuss these national prayer points and praise reports. And the first one she sends is that the United States Supreme Court, as Brother Mark pointed out so clearly, they're to hear a religious liberty case. And you can read about the lineup of the most significant cases of religious liberty that the nine justices will be hearing. And we look forward to that. Religious liberty legislation that's coming up. And also the state of Florida. Christian high school banned from praying over the loudspeaker. And that shouldn't happen in America, but it has. And also in Florida, a judge ruled that organizations can indeed continue helping prisoners, which is very good, in my opinion.
It's better than good.
Yeah.
That's the command of Jesus. If you didn't visit me in prison,
yep,
I don't know you.
And then the disciples said, well, Lord, when did we see you in prison? Well, you know, they couldn't remember seeing him in prison. And Jesus said, well, inasmuch the least of these, you did it unto me.
And let us remember that most everything Jesus commanded us to do, he did himself. He went and visited John in jail.
Amen.
And a lot of people forget that.
Yeah, and Jesus was more than a philosopher. He was more than a preacher. He was a practitioner.
He was.
He was a practitioner.
He was a doer.
And that's exactly what, you know, James said. You know, we need to realize over 10 years ago we had a Korean congregation that were not related to Baptists. In fact, they were related to my dear friend D. James Kennedy in a Presbyterian church. But about 10 or 12 years ago, they came over and said, we believe the Bible teaches that we ought to be doers of the word, not hearers only. And so they started coming here over 10 years ago, and they come every month now to be doers of the word.
Church fair.
Amen. Church fair. Exactly right. And he's the man that started that work. That's where I stole that. And
no, I didn't steal it. Didn't steal it.
I doubt
came from the Lord, and it's mine to give.
Amen. Thank you, brother. And also...
And we aren't done with it, folks.
Absolutely.
You're going to see the next wave of church fair coming. You're going to see the next prayer train coming. And I'm here to tell you, you better get on the train because it's leaving the station.
Amen.
Don't be left behind.
Amen.
Get out in front.
Amen.
You don't want to be like Mr. Obama and be leading from behind. Let your behind catch up in a hurry.
Amen. And by the way, if you're going to write this down, get your pen out. I know it's a long way till July, but that'll get here.
It's just a blink.
We'll get there before we know it. On July the 11th, we're going to board what I'm calling the train wreck prayer team. We're going to, because we believe America's in a wreck.
It's off the tracks.
It's off the tracks. So we're going to get on a train. We're going to get on an Amtrak train at 6:15 at Alvaro Street. We're going to have a taco at Alvaro Street. And then we're going to go over to Union Station. And there at Union Station, we're going to board the train for Washington, D.C.
Let me suggest to some of our listeners out there who may not know, and some of my good Chinese friends who might have tuned in, let me suggest that Alvaro Street is directly downtown. There's a little pole right there at Alvaro Street that is the exact center of Los Angeles.
Mm-hmm.
And it was the original place where the first Catholic mission, the oldest house in Los Angeles is right there.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's a beautiful little street. And there's an old Methodist church that Dr. Mark used to have an office in. And that's where we started our hip-hop ministry that went worldwide.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm here to tell you, right next door is the Biscaloos Building, a famous man in Los Angeles. And right across the street, on X, which is a post office, and the oldest post office, all of California, incidentally. And on this side is Union Station. And I'm telling you, folks, you're time to get on board and get on track.
By the way, if you'd like to RSVP, we're not selling tickets. We're not getting tickets. I have already arranged for my ticket to Washington, D.C., from Union Station, L.A., to Union Station, D.C., and I'm going. And I hope Brother Mark and others will join us and get on the train. We will Monday at 6:30, and we will get into Washington, D.C. on Thursday. And we will go through 48 train whistle stop prayer meetings, 48 all across the nation, stopping in 15 different states. And if you'd like to go with us, maybe you'd join us halfway. Maybe you'd join us in Albuquerque or wherever. Go. There's two trains that we'll be taking. One train all the way, Union Station to Union Station. But we do have to change trains in Chicago.
Chicago.
And so we go out here on the Southwest Chief. Southwest Chief from here to Chicago, and then from Chicago we take the Capital Limited, and you can go online at Amtrak and check those two out and see exactly when we come through your town. I'll not go through the listing of all of them today, but you can go to the schedule on Amtrak and you'll see every train every station we'll be stopping.
Now, friends, the last time we did the prayer train across America, we went through 15 states and 51 cities.
Mm-hmm.
And we had a unique train breakdown in the middle. And
yeah,
we ended up having a guitarist and a kind of famous singer.
Yeah,
and we were singing and got the whole train singing, putting peace on the train. And the conductors came later and said, "We're so glad that you guys were aboard. But we fasted and prayed, and we encourage you to fast and pray with us as this train goes across America, and that you earnestly seek to come out." And let me suggest an idea, Pastor.
Okay.
I'd like to suggest that all the churches in all of these states and these different whistle stops that are along the way, that they sponsor someone to come out and get on the prayer train and to go and pray with us.
Amen.
And I think that's a representation of every fellowship of the real true desire under 2 Chronicles 7:14, that if my people, who's that? Called by my name, whose name? The name of Jesus, will repent and turn from their wicked ways, then, oh, that's a condition and a promise.
Amen.
I will hear their prayer in heaven and heal their land.
Amen.
So we don't need to pray America back. We want to pray America forward.
Amen.
But we want to restore America because it's a train wreck and we want it back on the tracks.
That's right.
So we have to first get on tracks ourselves. We've got to get our fellowships on track and the body of Christ on track and lead, not from behind, but in front.
Amen.
We're not going to give up our religious liberties.
Amen.
That Christ paid a price for,
Amen.
That the founding fathers paid a price for, because somebody doesn't like what we're doing.
Amen.
And I don't care if his name is Bush or Obama or whomever else.
Amen.
It's about us.
That's right.
One thing we can say about this election cycle, Pastor, Bernie Sanders is doing America a favor. Donald Trump is doing America a favor. They're serving our country by showing the establishment and the political parties that they're not in control. We, the people, are the ones who make that decision. And it's God's people
Amen.
Who should be leading that.
Amen.
And so we should be thankful for what they're doing. We don't have to agree with what they say. We don't necessarily have to agree with their agenda. But boy, we should be praising the Lord Almighty for what they're doing. And as you know, I have prophesied that this would come
mm-hmm.
and that
Amen.
What is happening is happening. And I also prophesied that you would have a seat at the table because God's prophetic voice would be heard, and your greatest gift is as a prophetic prayer warrior.
Amen.
And so,
thank you, Lord.
Folks, you're seeing the fruits of fulfillment of earnest prayer before the throne of grace.
Amen.
And for each and every one of you who have participated as an anointed prophet and apostle of God, ordained by the faith community in my authority, I speak a blessing back to you. God bless you for that hard
Amen.
Work and those earnest prayers.
Amen.
We thank you.
Amen. Now, if you'd like to go with
Amen.
Us.
Amen. That's a perfect transition. Can I cut in here?
Sure. Sir? Sure, Donnie. Go ahead.
And, Minister Mark. Yeah, I'm Brother Minister Johnny Rice. And I agree with you on that prophecy, Brother. God spoke to me, Minister Mark, 2009 was, the Holy Ghost spoke to me, said Obama is the chosen one as the Antichrist, and I'm gonna show you proofs of it. I'm gonna start giving you more revelations. You're gonna see the news. You're gonna see him rise up as the Antichrist, and I'm going to use you as an anti-messenger, like Dr. Jack Van Impe and Perry Stone and others. I went to Israel with Perry Stone twice and studied all that stuff. And so he spoke to me that Obama was the chosen one. And so I've been sharing this with Pastor Wiley and, going on Capitol Hill, sharing with congressmen, different Christian congressmen especially, about this and how he fulfills the prophecies. Even, even unsaved congressmen, been sharing with them. Charlie Rangel, I told Charlie Rangel that Obama was the chosen one to be the UN world leader, and he said, well, that's great, we sure need him as a UN world leader. And I said, no, congressman. He got in the elevator. The doors were closed. And I said, no, congressman. That means he's the Antichrist of Revelation 13. And I want to say a prayer right now. And God also spoke to me, Minister Mark, that Trump, and I didn't care about Trump, never watched his TV program, The Apprentice. I mean, I just know the name now after all this. But God really spoke to me. He said, I'm raising up Trump, and his name, look at his name, John, his name is Trump, and I want to use him to trump this Antichrist system for a season.
Yes,
amen.
That's right, that's right.
For a season.
That's right.
To defeat Hillary witchcraft meetings from Arkansas to California. And, I mean, just there's just so much about Hillary, Secret Service thing. And if they even say good morning to her.
Brother, the important thing for us is to have a spiritual eye, and God's given you a spiritual eye, so we are to see and announce and proclaim that the gospel is alive, and it says, in the days when evil shall appear to be good, and good evil, and we must be mindful that it says even one-third of the elect, the elect, those are believers, will be deceived.
Yes.
So we're in the tribulation now that people don't understand, and we must mount up with spiritual warfare.
Amen.
And so I receive what you're saying, and understand what you're saying, and we need to be vigilant.
God spoke to me, brother, Minister Mark. He didn't promise me Trump would win. I mean, he said start. Supporting Trump, tell the pastors to support Trump. I spoke to the Republican, you know, a lot of the Republicans at the Capitol about Trump. I said, look, you know, Congressman, this, you guys need to rally behind Trump. I know you guys don't like him. I know you want to kick him out of the arms of the shenanigans, but he put a bullseye on his head. Like no one else.
Yes.
Only Alex Jones was pretty much, to me, spiritually, was a bullseye really attacking this satanic New World Order system. But Trump, you know, has risen above Alex, you know, and Alex even said that people in the Secret Service told him privately that he didn't interview him. But they told Alex, Trump is the most one we have to protect the most. He's the most guy that they want to do an assassination attack against because he's exposing everything like Alex Jones. Congressman, he's like Alex Jones on steroids. I mean, he's exposing.
Brother, if I might interject, let me suggest the following. He's simply saying what most of us are feeling and seeing, and God put him there to be a voice.
Amen.
And it says very simply in the scripture, the prophet shall come from the west to east to shout the warning. So whether it's Pastor Wiley Drake or Donald Trump or Ted Cruz or Marco Rubio, they're all good men who stand and speak for what the posture of Almighty God desires.
That's right.
And we, as you have graciously announced, that we know who the villain is here.
Amen.
In Hillary. So any one of those men, I would take over her any day of the week.
Candidates like Pastor Wiley Drake, you know, behind the scenes, me and Pastor, you know, maybe another pastor in Harlem, Pastor David Manning. We had a meeting with Pastor David Manning in Harlem, who's doing Harlem for Trump campaign, and also Mike Huckabee. You know, I mean, Trump, he really messed up Fox News' debate.
Yeah.
You know, just a couple nights ago.
Well, Brother Johnny, let me do this.
He did that veterans, and he brought in, this is what God was showing me, he brought Mike Huckabee and Santorum together. So he's starting, and you know, he needs to bring the other candidates in as a dream team with the White House to take over the White House to overcome Hillary, and no offense to Bernie, but also Bernie.
Pastor, listen, let me ask you if you would, because all of this is, you know, we're running out of time, but also...
Well, let me just say the prayer.
That's what I want. That's what I want to say. If you'll go ahead and pray for us and listen as the scripture. Please do.
Well, before you do, let me say this real quickly. While Donald Trump blows his own horn, Wiley Drake's leading because he blows the shofar horn.
Amen. And that's the Wiley Drake shofar he's going to blow.
You know, I know Donald, you know, anyhow, minister, have Pastor Wiley, if I
I'll get it to you.
As my Chinese friends would say, Mei Wen Ti. No problem.
No problem. Yeah. All right.
Okay. Numbers chapter 10, verse 9, and it says, and if you go to war in your land against the enemy that oppresses you, that's oppressed America, oppressed the Christians, then you shall blow an alarm with the trumpets, with a shofar, and you shall be remembered before the Lord your God, and you shall be saved from your enemies. So I'm going to blow the shofar, Pastor Wiley Drake shofar that he's letting me use here in Washington, D.C.
Go ahead.
And, hallelujah. Let's do it.
Hallelujah. Thank you, brother.
Thank you, Father God, for Pastor Wiley Drake and Pastor Minister Mark God and all they're doing, God. And thank you, God, that tonight is a big night prophetically. Up Donald Trump, God, and his dream team, which includes myself and Pastor Wiley Drake and Mike Huckabee and Minister Mark. All of us are going to join together, God, to work with Donald Trump, God, in the mighty name of Jesus, by the blood of Jesus. Let Trump win in tonight, God. Let it be a big landslide victory. God, let Ted Cruz join, hallelujah, this team, God, in the mighty name of Jesus, by the blood of Jesus. Cover Donald Trump with the blood of Christ. Cover his vehicles, God, and Holy Spirit, move. And let us open the door for Wiley Drake and myself and Mike to work as advisors, prophetic advisors for Donald Trump in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
God, bring salvation to Hillary Clinton and Obama, God. Bring salvation. Deliver them of their satanic antichrist spirits.
Amen.
Thank you. In the mighty name of Jesus, that we're going to have prosperity and Christianity in America.
Amen.
Take over the White House in Jesus' name.
Amen. And I would remind myself, first of all, Brother Mark, Minister Johnny Rice, Brother David here, and all of us, I would remind myself, not from my words, but from the very lips of our Lord, when he said, I urge then, first, petitions, prayers, intercessions, and thanksgiving be made for all people. My pastor friend used to say, all, be made for all people, for kings, that includes presidents, for kings and all those in authority, that we may live peaceable and quiet lives in all godliness and holiness. And of course, that's Psalm 91 in 1 Timothy where Paul taught us, and we want to take that teaching. And we want to continue to pray for all branches of our government, not just those that are making mistakes, but all branches of our government. And I thank you, Minister Johnny, for blowing the shofar. Ladies and gentlemen, that's the shofar that came with me from Jerusalem to Washington, D.C. And I carried it back and forth several times to blow the trumpet, to blow the shofar, as Brother Mark had mentioned. And as I traveled with it, it became a little cumbersome because they were not sure they wanted to allow a wild animal horn on the airplane. And so several months ago I was in Washington and I was at Faith in Action's office. And as I stood there in that office, they had a mantelpiece. And I said, would it be possible for me to put my shofar on the mantle and leave it here from time to time when I come to town? And they said yes. Faith in Action, Brother Pat Mahoney and Brother Rob there, Rob Shank and Miss Peggy and them said, we will dedicate it to be God's shofar under the leadership of Pastor Wiley Drake and the Congressional Prayer Conference. And we leave it there on the mantelpiece. And when we were in town a few weeks ago, we took it off the mantelpiece and put it in the hands of Minister Johnny Rice. And he is continuing to play it on Capitol Hill. And we thank him for that.
And now it's getting used 24/7, Pastor. Not collecting dust as a museum piece, but breaking spiritual,
Yes.
In D.C., hallelujah, opening up the windows of heaven and pouring us down blessings, and it's a really prophetic, because I knew I was supposed to get a shofar, but I just didn't feel like I was supposed to buy one.
Yeah, amen. Well, brother, let me sort of take over here again, and since we're on television, we got to do one last commercial. And that commercial is, if you would like to join putting America back on the track, and you'd like to go on that train trip with us July the 11th and be there on that weekend, the 16th, because that's going to be a great meeting. We're going to have 1 million people on the hill. God has told us that, and we're going to have 1 million people on the mall on the 16th, which is on Saturday. But we're going to pray it in as we pray across America, and we encourage you to be a part of it. Now, here's the advertisement. If you would like to RSVP, you can do that at my phone number. I'll give you a 202 number, 202-747-4839. Call that phone number and say, I will be on the train. You're not getting anything from us, but we want you to RSVP so we know that people are indeed going to be coming. RSVP at 202-747-4839. That is the number in D.C. It's a number that rings with me as well, coast to coast, and that's the number you can RSVP on. We want to remind you, we'll be back tomorrow morning. Tomorrow morning on the Wiley Drake Show, Dr. Robert Ornelas, who was vice presidential candidate in years past, but he is also a presidential candidate. We will have another presidential candidate, not only Wiley, but Robert Ornelas on the show with us tomorrow morning. Call in, pray with him, pray for him, and if you have a question for a presidential candidate, you can ask any question you want to ask, and we'll allow you to do that. May God bless you, and may God help you, and have a great evening in the Lord Jesus Christ. Folks, it's time for us to get out of here. And as they say over across the way here, short few miles away in Hollywood, that's a wrap. We'll see you.
Yo, baby, yo.
Yo, baby, yo. We'll see you tomorrow.
God bless you guys, ministers. Hallelujah.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.